Welcome to the Nonprofit Report, your update on nonprofit organizations, issues, and leaders. I'm your host, Mark Oppenheim. Today, we're discussing a devastating problem that is deeply intertwined with poverty, and that problem is hunger. And one of Mississippi's great organizations that is trying to address the problem of hunger in that state. Special guest, Charles Beady, Jr., Chief Executive Officer of the Mississippi Food Network, has dedicated his time to addressing this issue in which one in four Mississippians, about 600,000 people, don't have enough to eat, including about a quarter of Mississippi's children and well over half of Mississippi's seniors. That's 56% who regularly experience hunger. If 25% of Americans had COVID, it would be a pandemic. So by that measure, we've had a decades-long pandemic of hunger in Mississippi. And Charles, could you help us understand the scale of this issue and the scale of your operations as you try to address it?
Sure. I guess the best way to look at it is Mississippi is the poorest state in the nation. Mississippi is the hungriest state in the nation. Mississippi is the most obese state in the nation. When I talk to people about Mississippi being the hungriest and the most obese, they often wonder, well, how can you be hungry and obese at the same time? Well, you're talking about poor folks, folks who are hungry and food insecure, eating the wrong kinds of foods, eating more calories than nutrients. Mississippi has the lowest life expectancy of any state in the nation. Mississippi has the largest number of single parent households at over 11%. We have the third highest rate of diabetes in the country. We lead the nation in deaths per 100,000 as of 2020. So that just gives a little background in terms of what we're dealing with as we attempt to provide food to those who are hungry and food insecure in our great state.
And this is in the heart of the United States. So we basically have, within the heart of the United States, a third world country that is poor, impoverished, and systematically so for many decades. How do we, first of all, we have an immediate need. So let's talk about the immediate need, and then let's talk about systematically uplifting the state and its citizens. Talk about how we deal with the immediate issue of there is no food on the table today for a child. There is no food on the table today for a senior. How do you address that? And how do you make sure that your supply chain is filled with goods so that you can address it?
Well, we do have some supply chain issues, but I think, as you mentioned earlier, over 600,000 people in our great state go to bed hungry, either hungry or not knowing how or when they'll get their next meal. That includes over 220,000 children and 100,000 senior citizens. And we're doing our best to get as much food as we can to those folks who need it. When I first came here in 2014, I was told by the people from Feeding America, our national partner, that we needed to get about 90 pounds of food per individual in need of food throughout the state of Mississippi. That amounts to over 54 million pounds of food. When I first came in 2014, we were distributing about 18 to 20 million pounds of food. Then we got up to about 20 million pounds of food. At the height of the pandemic, we distributed 42.6 million pounds of food. We're starting to trend back toward pre-pandemic levels. Last year, we distributed a little over 30 million pounds of food, but still going back in the wrong direction, I guess. Not necessarily the wrong direction, pre-pandemic levels. So we're distributing as much as we possibly can with the resources that we have available to us.
Charles, in order to get the food to various constituents that you've mentioned, you have a number of different programs. Can you describe those programs and how those connect to consumers of your product, which is nourishment?
Oh, absolutely. We have one of the programs is called a backpack program, where we provide nutritious meals over the weekend to the students who need it. Many of the students we serve only get nutritious meals from the schools that they go to. Interestingly, when we provide those backpacks to the students to take home, the whole family, in some instances, end up having to eating from the backpack meals that we provide. We have a summer food service program that just concluded this July. We have 11 sites, again, providing food to kids over the summer, where we provided 2,566 breakfasts and 4,411 lunches and 645 snacks. We have an after-school supper snack program. That program kicked off in October, usually in the fall. We're sponsoring 9 after-school snacks in 11 counties. We have a school pantry program where we actually provide a pantry in 7 schools in the Jackson area and 1 in the South Delta area, where we're providing food to 100 families per month. And I think I mentioned the backpack program that kicked off in September. We're partnering with 59 sites and serving an average of over 2,000 students per week. Just some of the program that we have in place. I need to talk briefly about our TFAP program, the Emergency Food Assistance Program. That's formerly referred to as the welfare program, where we're providing food to over 150,000 individuals per month. Again, at the height of our distribution during the pandemic, we distributed over 42.6 million pounds. And then there's a commodity supplemental food program where we're providing over 13,000 boxes of food, 30 pounds each, to senior citizens every month. Just an indication of some of the programs that we have going here at Mississippi Food Network.
The statistics are so compelling, and in particular, when you think about children who could not work, right? They are children. They need to be educated. They need to be cared for. Seniors who have gotten to the point where they perhaps aged out of the work environment, right? You're talking about families who together cannot necessarily muster the income required to purchase food, right? So in each of these cases, you're talking about today's need that needs to be fulfilled by somebody, or you end up having starvation in the center of the United States.
Exactly. Again, over 44 million people go to bed every night in this country either hungry or not knowing how or when they're going to get their next meal. We have the ability to provide the food that these people need. We just need to get our country in a situation where we have the resolve to make it happen.
Where does the food come from? Because Mississippi, if you look at Mississippi's economy, only 2.8% of Mississippi's economy is are in agricultural products. So you must be importing food from quite a distance. Is that correct?
Well, we're in a low resource state, no doubt about that. We get food from 3 sources: the federal government, purchased food, and donated food. About 60% of the food that we're distributing is coming from the federal government. The other 40% donated. We have a debt of gratitude owed to the big stores in the area, the Sam, the Walmarts, the Krogers, and places like that. We have people who host food drives for us, some of the local high schools, the Mail Carriers Association, just any number of organizations that will host food drive and bring that food to us for distribution to the folks we serve. And then we're fortunate that the folks who donate to us provide enough funds, or at least some funds, for us to be able to purchase food to get it to the folks who need it.
And then getting that food to the folks who need it, that's a logistical issue. And with gas prices going so high, that has got to have impacted everyone, right? Whether one is a volunteer, right, yes, to drive to a place or or there's a grower, or there's a retail outlet that is donating food. Those logistics prices must be really killing your ability to get food out to people and move food to where it's needed.
Absolutely. Gas price issues, diesel price issues, supply chain issues. I was at a meeting in Atlanta the other day. We talked about some of our food coming from the federal government. One of the things that they indicated to us at the meeting is that we wouldn't be getting a lot of cereals in this year. So I wonder, why not cereal? Well, you got the war going on over in Ukraine that supplies a lot of grain to folks throughout the country. Droughts going on in the in this country. There will be a shortage of grain. And as a result, we're not able to get cereal. Again, we get a lot of our food coming from the federal government, and we're grateful for that. We are able to, a lot of people think that we provide food directly out of our warehouses to the people who need it, but we have some 430 agencies in our 56 county service area that we provide the food to. If an agency is within a 75-mile radius of us, they'll bring their trucks and trailers to pick up the food they order. I put order in parentheses. We don't sell anything. They order it online. They come pick it up and take it back to their respective communities. If they're outside of that 75-mile radius, we'll load up. We have four tractor trailers. Load up 40,000 pounds of food and take it to a drop-off area in the Cleveland area, North Mississippi, and then the agencies in that area will pick up their orders and take it back to their respective communities. So we have a good, we're Mississippi Food Network, and our network allows us to distribute the food to the folks who need it.
The thing that strikes me is how sophisticated this operation is, just from a logistics point of view, right? You have centralized warehouses, but not everything goes through each of those centralized warehouses. You have places where goods are offloaded and then redistributed, but you also have, and you have transshipment points and so on and so forth, but you also have the ability to move between nodes in that network. So it's not like a wagon wheel where the hub and spoke only, right? You might have several hubs, or you might actually have connections directly between various nodes. So it's an extremely sophisticated operation. How do you ensure that you have staff and people and agreements and memoranda of understanding and all that other stuff to make it all work? And then there's also the grease that makes any machinery work, which is goodwill, cooperation, and communication. How do you make sure that this actually functions from a business perspective as a leader, a coordinator, a facilitator in your own role?
Well, it sounds sophisticated. It's relatively simple, though. We are the only Feeding America affiliated food bank physically located in the state of Mississippi. I think there are about 15 states. There are 200 food banks nationally affiliated with Feeding America. We're one of 15 states that only has one physically located in the state. And we just work hard. We're, certified as a large food bank by Feeding America, but we are distributing normally 20 million pounds. So we are a big food bank. We're a small food bank doing big food bank distribution, I guess is the best way to put it. Again, we have our 18 wheelers available to us. We distribute the food through some 430 agencies. Again, in our 56 county distribution area, we do that with some 37 employees, four tractor trailers, a couple of 32-foot box trucks, and we just make it happen with the folks that we have available to us.
You have an army of partners and volunteers. I think you're being too modest. You know what the difference is between your operation and a retail operation?
What's that?
It's the financial transaction. That's it, at point of sale. That's it. I mean, you basically are running with your small team, but also that army of volunteers, that army of partners and so on that, that you're helping to coordinate. You're running a very sophisticated business operation, and you claim it's easy. You perhaps make it look easy.
But no. I didn't say it was easy. Now it's not easy. But by way of comparison, I know of one of the Northern food banks that is responsible for attempting to trying to distribute food to some 600,000 people. They have a $34-35 million budget, a couple of hundred trucks, and a couple of hundred employees. We're trying to, the best that we can, distribute, get food to the 600 or so thousand people in the state of Mississippi who need it with a $6 million budget, 34 employees, and five or six trucks. So you can do the math on that one. We just work hard, lean into it, and make it happen with the resources that we have available to us. Not easy, but we make it happen.
Talk about the typical family that is coming to you. Is that typical family a individual? Is it a single mother? Is it, or a single parent household? Are it elderly? Or are there different cohorts that are coming to your partners in order to avail themselves of the food? And you're trying to, through your function, ensure that at the point where a family is picking up food or where they're receiving food, that whatever supply you can provide is meeting the needs of those little kids or also seniors?
Well, who's coming to us? All of the above. Everything
the above.
That you described.
Cross-section?
A cross-section. I used to tell people that we distribute food to the poor, but it's not the poor. What about the college professor who's lost for some reason has fallen out of good health, no longer able to bring home the bacon, as it were. So it's not just about being poor, it's about being in need. The pandemic only exacerbated the food hunger situation in the state of Mississippi. More people unemployed. So we talked about inflation earlier, supply chain issues. All of those factors play into increasing the number of people who are seeking our services.
So you're saying it cuts across professions, it cuts across age, it cuts across race. It's really just us all. It's if you're a Mississippian, you actually, and you have a lower level of income, the likelihood of you interacting with a food bank is quite high, since a quarter of your citizens do interact.
Right. Well, the preponderance of people we serve are poor, people who don't have the income needed to provide the kind of food that they need to their families. But again, we're talking about not just always the poor. But you don't have to be poor to be in need of our services. You don't have to be poor to for a variety of reasons needing to feed your family.
Let's talk about the interrelationship between nonprofits, governments, and business as purveyors of solution. How do you see this? You know, we often get into our politics between this whole idea of business being the solution or government being the solution, or, you know, with a whole bunch of argument in between. How do you see this in terms of the roles of various institutions, the three being that I'm citing, government, business, and nonprofits, but maybe we can also include churches there. How do you see these institutions interacting?
Well, when you ask that question, one of the things that goes through my mind is we throw away enough food, we plow under enough food every year to feed everybody who's hungry in the United States of America.
Why do we do that?
Say that again.
Why do we do that?
Why do we do that? We lack the national resolve to make it happen. Certainly politics plays has a lot to do with it. We just, for whatever the reason, don't have the national resolve to feed the people who need to be fed in the United States of America. Every night, over 40 million people go to bed hungry, either hungry and not knowing how or when they're going to get their next meal. And you contrast that with the fact that we produce enough food to feed all those people. The question becomes, why? Politics?
Politics, or is it also that our priorities as individuals, my priorities as a person, as an American citizen, my priorities need to be adjusted? Is it, don't we each bear a bit of personal responsibility for the how our country operates in this?
I agree with that. Certainly, trying to do the best that I can as an individual, as a proud citizen of this country, to try to help those who are less fortunate. In the role that I'm in here at Mississippi Food Network, I'm proud to be a member of the Feeding America organization of food banks. We feed collectively. We provide billions of meals every year to the folks who need it. So we're doing our best at our level to try to make it happen. We're not the only organization in the state of Mississippi providing food to those who need it. We're probably one of the largest, if not the largest. So we just do what we can with what we can to make it happen.
So maybe one of the things that we should think about is, instead of diverting into arguments, seeing what we can do to resolve these issues personally, right? Instead of thinking about who I can argue with, instead thinking about who I can collaborate with. Exactly. In order to fix an issue. So let's talk about those fixes. Let's start dealing with some systemic issues in terms of how we can, once the need of today's hunger is satisfied, what part of our energy, what action should we take in order to try and systemically address these issues in Mississippi and the nation? What is the first thing that you think of when you think about solving the issue of hunger?
Well, I'm a former educator, spent many years in education, having been the former president of one of the nation's historically Black boarding schools. So the first thing that comes to mind when you ask me that question is our inability to provide education primarily to those who need it the most. I think from a systemic standpoint, we need to be focusing more on our schools. The best way traditionally to climb out of poverty is to get yourself a good education. And I'm a good example of that. So that's one of the first things that I would think about and attempt to deal with as we talk about hunger, food insecurity, systemic issues that cause it.
So let's talk about that, because I came from a family that valued education first above everything. Did your family value education first above everything as well?
The first thing I think about is my father telling me, don't bring me home no C's. A C is just as close to the bottom as it is to the top. So I was always encouraged and made to be, encouraged to do the best that I possibly can to be as good a student as I possibly could in order to make a better life for myself than my parents had.
And this was basically, in your father's eyes and your parents' eyes, about self-sufficiency. Once you have an education, you can go in the direction that you determine rather than a direction that is determined for you.
I agree with that wholeheartedly. I just think about, again, being raised in Flint, Michigan. I was Boy Scout Troop 53, went off to usher a football game at Michigan State University. And that day, I decided that I was going to Michigan State and make a better life for myself. And I was able to realize that dream.
So when you collaborate with organizations, I know some of the organizations you collaborate are focusing on the immediate need. Are you also collaborating with organizations, or do you see organizations across Mississippi that are both dealing with the immediate need, but also trying to systemically change this issue of education and create within the citizens of Mississippi greater opportunity for self-sufficiency so that the state itself can become stronger and there is less hunger?
Well, we're collaborating basically with those organizations that have the a purpose of trying to get food to those who need it. As a citizen, I'm concerned about issues like education, systemic racism, and those kinds of things in the state of Mississippi. But my primary focus like a laser beam on doing what we can here at Mississippi Food Network to get food to our fellow citizens who need it the most.
In terms of the people that you hire, the 37 people, talk a little bit about their profiles and their expertise.
Well, the first thing I think about is Mike Roche. Mike's been with us almost 20 years now. He came here before I did. Mike blew in from New Orleans with the hurricane some 20 years ago, and he was down at the center, we call it, down in on the fairground with his family. They had to leave. They didn't have a place to stay. And the fellow who was the previous executive director of Mississippi Food Network saw him, asked him if he was needed a job. Mike said yes. He's been with us for 20 years now, and he is the man who makes things happen in the warehouse. I can't say enough about the people that I work with. Cass, who's been here for 20 years, our director of agency relations. Quincy, who just joined us a couple of years ago, our operations manager. My executive assistant, Bevelin. We worked together at Pineywood when I was the president there. She's been serving with me for 8 years now. I couldn't say enough about the people that I work with. I love them and just glad to be a part of the team.
You're pointing out something that is so true, right? Talent is everywhere. Sometimes people come to me, you know, we do executive search work and people come to me and say, where are all the this type of talent or all the that type of talent? And basically, you know, look to your left, look to your right, you're probably going to see somebody right around you that has the talent that you need. And there are a lot of options out there. It doesn't mean that it's easy to assemble a team that is high functioning. There is an art to it, of course, but the talent is all over the place. And it could be somebody who's been displaced by a hurricane, right?
You're absolutely right. I just think, as you mentioned that, I think about how I got to Mississippi Food Network. Again, I was served as president of the boarding school for a number of years, left there and went to D.C. and worked for a while. Came back to Tennessee and worked for a while at a little school in Tennessee, elementary, junior high, with a boarding school component. And while I was there, I got a call from a friend of mine in the Virgin Islands, known him for 30 years. He asked me if I would come work at the University of the Virgin Islands at the Virgin Islands University Center for Excellence in Developmental Disabilities. So I was there for about five years, thinking about maybe halfway retiring there, maintaining a home back here in Mississippi. And then I got a call from a friend indicating that there was a position available. My wife and I prayed about it, prayed for the one with my name on it. But when I found out that Mississippi Food Network was located on Beady Street, that was, I think, God's way of saying it's time for you to go back to Mississippi. I'm Charles Beady. We're located on Beady Street, spelled a little different, but pronounced the same. So I was there in the Virgin Islands. I got a call, and here I am back in Mississippi.
You're also pointing out that it's, you know, we say that God works in mysterious ways, right? It's
absolutely.
It's really about trying to think beyond the conventional preconception of how people work, what their career paths are going to be, trying to get beyond what a path that is set before you, because that path might meander. It might have different waypoints. It might have different career stints. There might be competencies that you've applied in one circumstance that in this circumstance happen to have fantastic resonance. And that's what you and some of your people have found. Let me ask you about your idea about management and about the structure of organizations, because there's a very traditionalist idea about how management should work. You know, it's embedded in these hierarchical charts, right, where you have, you know, the chief executive at the top, and then you have another layer, and then you have another layer, you know, it comes into a pyramid and all this other stuff. Control and power and decision-making is very centralized. Do you see the organization working in that way, or do you have a different idea of a neural network or different, you know, centers of expertise? How do you manage as a leader, whether it's in a boarding school or in this organization? What's your philosophy?
Well, the first thing that goes through my mind is the boss tells people what to do. A leader helps people get it done. I believe in shared governance. I have a good team of folks. We meet on a regular basis.
Believe in listening.
I believe in I wear hearing aids. I have a hearing disability. I have to listen. So I pay particular attention to the notion of listening. I get advice from the people who serve on my executive council, so to speak. I'm the one where the buck stops. But again, believing in shared governance, I use their information to help me make the kinds of decisions that need to be made here at Mississippi Food Network. And that notion has not failed me, either here or in prior positions.
Are your attributes, you talk about a hearing disability, are your attributes actually God's gift in terms of how you concentrate your mind and the navigation that you do? How do you see that idea of your particular who you are and all the things that you are in terms of informing your leadership and your ways of listening, of concentrating, of directing your energies? Do you see this as something to grieve over, that you have hearing loss? How do you deal with that?
No. We were in a meeting a couple of days ago, and one of the folks on the team asked someone, what is your superpower? My superpower is the ability to listen. Again, because of my hearing disability, I have to listen. I can listen between the lines. I can hear stuff that people don't often hear because I have to focus more on listening. So it's God's gift in a way.
And maybe by also not having great hearing, you're paying attention to your other senses, and you're picking up messages that previously you might have been less sensitive to. You know, those are all different gifts that can be explored, you know, particularly as we get older, right? Because we're not going to be as physically capable as we were in our younger days. There are some real advantages. I don't want to glorify aging because it's, you know, it's happening to us all, but maybe a mind shift actually keeps us with youthful attitudes.
Oh, absolutely.
As we exercise our skills.
Yeah.
In terms of how you work with your partners and creating those partnerships, those understanding, are you basically functioning on a formal basis with a bunch of contract-like documents, or is it mostly on a handshake and communication and trust and person to person?
Just a little bit about how we're set up. Again, we have 430 agencies over 56 counties. We have a director of agency relations. I mentioned Cass a little bit earlier. She's out in the field more than I am. Every once in a while, I get a chance to go out and look at and talk with and interact with some of the people at the agencies. But most of them are church related, 501c3s. Again, they have to be in order to receive the some of the foods that we distribute. So we're on a good. We have a good working, not formal. There's paperwork that's required. but we have a good working human being relationship with the people who run the pantries that we distribute the food through.
So, you know, that combination is so very important, right? You're mentioning a number of different components that work together. You're mentioning, yes, there is some paperwork that needs to be done, right? There's a formal component. There's a communication component, right? There is the whole issue of predictability and trust, right? It's values-based. And this whole idea that really, while you might have a piece of paper, the handshake is just as important, right? The fact that somebody can call their counterpart up and talk with them and talk about their need or talk about a problem or, you know, I'm sorry to disappoint, but I can't deliver this today. That trust, and I'll make it up for you tomorrow, and then making it up for tomorrow, right? That trust is so important. I mean, it really is the way we've gotten too rigid in many respects. We've gotten too litigious in many respects. We need to deal with the values, don't we, in order to make this society work properly, in order to solve our bigger problems?
I agree with that wholeheartedly. Again, the majority of the people we serve come from lower socioeconomic background, and they, each and every one, is just as deserving as anybody else of being treated with the utmost respect in terms of our interaction with them, providing food to those who need it. No one's better than anybody else, I guess.
No one's better than anyone else. That is the point, isn't it? No one is better. We're helping each other. And today, if you need help, tomorrow you might give help, right?
There, but for the grace of God, go I.
Go I.
I agree with that 100%.
Charles, what a great, great exit thought, because it is so important that we remember this. Charles Beady, Jr., Chief Executive Officer of Mississippi Food Network, thank you so much for your work. Thank you for explaining how you work in Mississippi. You and Mississippi are a inspiration to us all. And really, thank your network, your employees, your board, your funders, and thank you. Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you for having me. Have a great day.
Have a great day.